Okay, I'm giving a talk about EAPI 7, so this will be quite technical. I'd given a talk about EAPI 6 2 years ago. I'll give you a short introduction about EAPIs, and then I'll come immediately to the features of EAPI 7, and I'll start with the easy ones, removals and easy features, and then I'll continue to present some of the more difficult or controversial features. Let's just see. EAPI is the Ebuild Application Programming Interface, which is the interface between ebuilds and the package manager. And it's specified in the package manager specifications, which you can find on this wiki page. We have a PMS project. And to have a new EPI, of course, it starts with discussing ideas, like in the dev mailing lists. And then normally we trace all the features via bugs. At some point, we just collect a set of features and get some pre-approval by council. And then this is in order to work on a specific ones, and then it's the time to write a specification, implement it in Portage, and of course, after all that is done, we will get some final approval by council. And it takes time. We have about one new EAPI about every other year. And the last one took a bit longer. I'll come to the reasons for that, and which is not so bad because you don't want dozens of EAPIs in the tree. What's this strange box? Let's look at the history. This is one of these plots by Dilfrich. So the concept was introduced sometime in 2007, 2008, and then this is just the curves for the different EAPIs, and meanwhile, the numbers 1, 2, 3 are banned from the tree, so these are all decreasing. And 4 has been deprecated about 1 year ago, and this red curve is EAPI 6, which was just approved almost 1 year ago. So you see, now we have 5, which is still by far the largest number of e-builds, and then 6 is continuously rising. Okay, let's go back to EAPI 6. And what did we have? We have the increased bash version to 4.2 finally, and a lot of features. I won't go through all the details. One important feature is the EApply support, which is a substitute for ePatch, and then now we require every e-build to call this e-apply user function in source prepare, so it's easy to apply user patches. And one second important feature is maybe this e-install docs support. This is called by the default source install, and it's some means to install documentation files just by specifying them in a variable. Okay, did it take too long? It was more than 3 years delay after EAPI 5, and several reasons. People like to propose features, but people don't like to write specifications. So most features, what's this? I don't know what's happening there. I've never had this before. People don't like to write specifications, so it's mostly one person who had to write all the spec. And also we had some late changes. The exact behavior of this eApply function wasn't entirely clear. Then we had some details with EAPI user 2, you know, like what should be the return status, what should happen if you call this function twice, yeah, answer. Then only the first call should be active and everything else should be a no operation. And yeah, directories for profile files, this feature was postponed. And then we had some nasty surprise with these bash 4 case modifying operators in some locales. For example, the small I doesn't map to the capital I, and we had needed some late changes because of that. Okay, let's come to easy things for EAPI 7. Yeah, we have two variables called dest tree and ins dest tree, which are the locations set by the into and ins into functions. And these are the install locations for do bin and do ins and so on. Yeah, and yeah, why should these variables be exposed to the eBuild environment? There's no reason for that. And already in 2007, the removal was already suggested. It's no longer used in e-classes, so a good time to finally get rid of this. Then, yeah, do HTML. Most of the audience should be devs. Can anyone tell me what these 7 options do? Or what are these 8 filename extensions? Yeah, there are bugs open, they're just more filename extensions. So it's HTML and .gif and whatever. And this doesn't really fit into any of the other do functions. Yeah, also PMS and portage don't have the same thing there. And in fact, it's a council decision to remove this with a next EAPI and use do doc minus r as a replacement. The council remains silent about the issue if a substitute in an e-class will be needed. So, okay, if anyone wants to do this in an e-class instead, just go ahead. Yeah. Easy features. Yeah. Bash version should probably be kept in sync with the stable version in the tree, so we can update to 4.3 or whatever is current when this is finalized. I think there's no need for much discussion. GNU patch. Currently, we don't require any minimum version. But probably we should require 2.7 to have this Git format patch support. And yeah, this is really nasty. And yeah, but let's do this in a well-defined way with an EAPI bump. Yeah, then this was already proposed last time. Yeah, most package and use files and profiles should support directories. Yeah, and also profiles package.mask should have directory support. This is not intended to be used in the Gentoo tree, but it's mainly for overlays, and it didn't make it into the last EAPI because of some technicalities. But I think this time we will be ready. Yeah, then package provided in profiles should be banned. Yeah, I haven't put this into the ban section because this is connected to the previous feature. If we don't remove this, we would have to support directories for this file too. Yeah, and on the other hand, it's listed as strongly deprecated in PMS already. It's not used in tree, so let's just get rid of this. Yeah, some output function EQA warn. This exists in portage since a long time, and there's some proxy function in eutils. So if the package manager doesn't support it, eutils will include it, which means all the ebuilds using that have to inherit the e-class. And yeah, easy feature to add to the package manager. Yeah, consistent install locations. This one was brought up by M. Gorney recently. This into function controls location for do bin, do sbin, do lib, and do mo. Yeah. Why do mo? It's mostly used for root directory versus USR directory. And yeah, there's no slash share. Yeah, so why should this affect this function? And then just let this do mo install into user share locale. Yeah, and it's really inconsistent to have it with the into function. Yeah, now the more difficult or controversial stuff. CLAP 62. Yeah, you should have some way to switch use flags at runtime and avoid rebuilding the package when you switch that use flag. And yeah, the details are specified in this CLAP. And yeah, it's not entirely clear what the syntax will be. Probably something like in parentheses with a star instead, and it's some substitute for the proposed, recommended, or suggested dependencies. And there's another bug for that one. Okay, I'm running out of time. Yeah, then, which is probably controversial, it's proposed to remove the trailing slash from all directory variables. Yeah, some of them have them, but there are ones like $d and $root which have a slash at the end. Yeah, and this typically leads to double slashes in the past, in the path, which is not a big issue, but it's proposed to remove the slash everywhere. And yeah, one problem is can root be empty in the most common case? And yes, why not? Yeah, why shouldn't it be empty? Okay, then there's this any of many dependency operator, this OR operator, and yeah, question is, can these two dependencies be switched at runtime? And it's not defined at the moment, and the suggestion is to replace it by two new dependency types with a star or with an equal sign, similar to the slot operator. And yeah, okay, the question is, how should a thing like this one, should this be allowed? Yeah, probably it shouldn't be allowed. And yeah, it's pending a ported implementation, and it's conditionally approved by council already. Yeah, then I had this last time already, version comparison and components. Yeah, we have this versionator.eclass, and yeah, it's slow. It's implemented in Bash. It's sometimes called in global scope, where you would want things to be reasonably fast. And yeah, we picked three functions: version comparison, version component instruction, and version separator replacement to implement in the package manager itself. And yeah, of course, if we implement it in Bash in the package manager, then again there's code duplication, and yeah, probably it needs some inter-process communication to do this in the package manager. Source fetch, yeah. Currently, VCS fetching is typically done in source unpack, which isn't so nice. And on the other hand, this would be only useful for live e-builds. So there's probably, yeah, it's. The e-builds which will go stable won't have this source fetch, obviously. Yeah. Okay, and then the never-ending story. new dependency types, host, target, build dependencies for cross-compiling, fetch dependencies. Someone has to pick this up, otherwise. This has been proposed since, look at the bug number, 180,000 something, and someone has to work out some reasonable proposal for this, otherwise. This won't happen. Okay, questions?
So on the subject of source fetch.
Yes.
Many years ago, I had a summer of code student that was writing an improved fetching tool overall. The net part of that code was never particularly used. Because we ran into a lot of corner cases where some of the fetching thing simply cannot be done trivially. VCS is the most evident part of it, but I presume you recently saw the discussion of people wanting to add a specific URL header for the good old games downloader. And there's a whole batch of related cases for that for otherwise restricted fetches that look like they're going to become common for at least a subset of things. The Steam game folks want something similar to make that side easier. And integration of those into parallel fetching, particularly when you want to pass off a whole batch of work to the fetcher, is difficult. How should that fit into future uses of source fetch? Should it be possible to hand off all packages by a certain URL to the fetcher at once? Do you have an opinion on the EAPI side of that, saying hand off to the fetcher, here's all the HTTP ones, go and deal with them at once?
Probably it should be, if we include this, then it should be a general solution for all these use cases. But of course, someone has to implement this.
This part is particularly difficult in that Portage needs to scan all of the fetches queued up and group them together. And that is not any functionality that exists in Portage to date.
I think the basic idea of this one was just to split off a function and just move all the bash code into this function. But of course, if you want to do anything special and you need additional dependencies and you want to do parallel fetching, then as you say, it will get quite complicated.
I have a question about do HTML removal. I agree that this feature is quite buggy, a limited number of types and so, but why it originated in the first place? Many documentation generation systems like DocSegen generate many garbage. And this garbage should be cleaned out before installing to the tree. Do we have any other handler to clean it up, or should it be done per build? It's a massive code duplication.
Feel free to move this to an E-class. I think an E-class is a better place for this filtering of things than to do it in the package manager.
This is reasonable. Another question is for package provider. Is it removed only from profiles?
Only from profiles. So your etc. Somewhere under etc. You can also have a package provider. This will stay, of course.
And for a problem with OR dependency and subslots, is there right now an issue with implementation, or do we have to make decision first? I don't get this clearly. Is it decided what to do and we just like implementation or we have
it's waiting for the implementation. Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, I think the decision is to be quite restrictive and don't allow things like, for example, don't allow that you switch the implementation, but don't switch subslots at the same time for the package. Yeah, this makes no sense. Yeah, and yes. We should restrict it to the useful cases. But it's waiting for implementation.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
There's one thing I've been wishing to Portage to have for a long time, and that's some way to correlate packages from different package managers. For example, if I use some language-based installer like PyPI or something like that, and there's also these auto-generated Python packages by GSPyPy or how it's called, and there are upstream or the packages in Portage. I have it's not easy to tell which package names and which packages are actually the same thing. And I think it would make sense to add to eBuild some identifier like the URL upstream URL of the package, for example, for PyPI repositories or something like that, so you can tell which packages in Portage are already in Portage and which ebuilds I have to auto generate for my overlay or something like that.
I think we have something like that in metadata.xml, but does anyone know? I think we added some, yeah.
For several types of repositories, we have generators, for example, for Octave generator, as far as I remember, there is an incentivic overlay. Some other packages are also trying to use package generators for massive, but that's quite complex to automate such things.
But I think the matching of upstream and Gentoo package names would belong in metadata, not into the eBuild itself. Yeah.